Okay, I guess I need to do another video, kind of like a refresher course, and that's in why not to do alignment. That's what you're not doing. You're not doing a transceiver alignment. You're doing a peak and tune. And why you should not do a peak and tune. I've said this before. I always tell my customers that. It's the worst thing you can do for your radio. Now, some people may actually be doing a proper transceiver alignment. They just call it a peak and tune, but that term usually means you're aligning the radio for, and that's what a lot of times customers will say, I want maximum swing, maximum smoke, maximum power output. Honestly, people, no, you don't. If you want to sound good and not distorted, with maximum power on channel, you don't want to tune for maximum smoke, maximum power, everything, because I'm not going to say this meter or a meter like that meter over there is lying. Actually, we can turn off this oscilloscope. I have no use for that one, what I'm going to be showing here. But power meters, you have to understand, they're, how's the best way to describe a RF watt meter? It's a dumb meter. It is. It's truly dumb. Even a peak reading meter. You can get really good meters. You can get peak kits to put in them. I have peak reading meters here. I have equipment that measures. Very accurate, actually. I have a communications test set. Does very accurate peak. I can measure and even positive and negative peaks. Can take measurements. But now that one, yeah, that actually will show it. But your average peak reading meters, even there, I'm not going to say they're lying to you, but they're still dumb. The problem with a peak, with any watt meter, is that it's reflecting, or it's displaying a representation in the needle movement, you know, calibrated to a scale, of exactly how much power is going into it. Now, all a meter does is, you increase the current to the meter movement, then the needle goes up more. If you reduce the amount of current going through the meter, the needle goes down. Very simple principle. All meters work that way. Every single meter you ever look at that has a needle that goes back and forth, they're all amp meters, basically. They just have different faces on them with dials calibrated for different readings, but that's basically all they are. Different amounts of current going through that meter movement make the needle move more. So it has no idea where that power is. Is that power, you know, is it a distorted signal? It can't do any of that. It's a dumb meter. And especially when you're working on radios, people think that, well, if the needle's going up more, so, you know, if I keep... Now, this is, for starters, let's start off with what this is. This is a new, unmolested Uniden PC78 LTW, okay? Brand new. Still has the, if you can see that little ripple there, it still has the protective plastic on it. I really like these radios. They're good. They're, you know, made by Uniden. I used to like Cobra radios. Until Uniden stopped making the boards for them. Yeah, contract dispute, that's a whole other story, whatever happened. But, you know, one of those things, before they stopped making this radio, I stocked up on them. So I've got like 5 or 6 of these brand spanking new in the box. Now, this one I had taken out of the box, but I'd never taken the covers off. So today is the first time any daylight's seen the inside of this radio since it was produced. And I thought this would be a good radio to demonstrate this on, because it hasn't been molested. Nothing's been clipped, no hackery's been done, no golden screwdrivering. It's not 50 years old and had 30 different people that have worked on it over the decades. It's as it left the factory. Now, I did just check it. I just tried to go through and just re-peak the transmit circuit just slightly, just to make sure it was right. And if, as usual with most factory radios, they always err on the side of caution, so output power is always going to be lower than the maximum allowed, and they do that for a reason. If they get caught selling radios that are putting out anything over FCC allowed limits, they can get fined, and the manufacturers don't want to get fined. So like I say, they always err on the side of caution. They always basically peak it, and then they detune it a little bit, just to be safe, which I can't blame them for doing that. But the problem is, like I say, people want to see that needle swinging. They want to see that needle moving. When they grab their microphone, they want to see some massive, they want to see that needle pegged against the other side of the, you know, the meter scale there. No, you don't. If your needle's pinging against the other side, you're probably a really good chance that you're distorted and you're not talking on whatever channel you're on. In this case, I've got the radio set to channel 19. You're probably talking on channel 19, channel 18, channel 17, channel 20, channel 21. You're also talking out into harmonics. So, you know, the second harmonic of channel 19 is 54.37 megahertz. That's, you know, that's the second. Take your fundamental frequency, multiply it by two. You'll have a bunch of crap showing up out there as well. Especially if you go cutting out components and tinkering with stuff like 54 megahertz trap circuits. Now, luckily in this radio, you can't do that. They've eliminated it. They've basically made it non-adjustable in these radios. So in the earlier days, and like I say, this is basically just a Cobra 29. Yes, it has a funky board right here, but that's because this is a weather radio. So it has the NOAA weather channels. You can ignore that board. That's basically your weather board. But you'll notice, used to have a coil that looked like this, or a tunable coil, used to be right here. It's not there anymore. They've gotten rid of it because they realize that if you put it there, people are going to tinker with it. And I've said that before, don't adjust that. That's the 54 megahertz trap circuit. Unless you have a spectrum analyzer, you cannot adjust that properly. And if you're adjusting it using a watt meter like that, or the one in the radio, or any other watt meter, an increase in power when you adjust that 54 megahertz trap circuit is not power on channel. That's not that your meter, that increase in power you're seeing on that meter right there, is not an increase. In the case of this radio, it's set to channel 19 right now. It would not be an increase in power at channel 19. That would be an increase of power showing up at 54.37 megahertz, the second harmonic. That's what that 54 megahertz trap circuit does. It traps that second harmonic and does not let it get out this little wire here, out the out the coax connector to your antenna. Prevents you from talking on television. So I want to show what happens when you peak a radio. Now, I'm not going to clip anything. Like I say, the AMC circuit, or the automatic modulation circuit. And what that circuit does is, it's meant that when you talk into your microphone, you're going to have peaks and valleys, and you know the volumes, it's not always constant. You might be moving different distances away from your mouth. Some people talk louder than others. So, you know, if we were only transmitting a continuous tone at a known input signal level, we wouldn't need an AMC circuit. We could just basically design the circuit around that exact audio frequency that was going in, and we'd have no problems. But we're using voice communications. So the levels, the audio frequencies, everything's, it's always varying. And we need a way to control that. And that's what the AMC circuit does, the automatic modulation control circuit. It does just as it says. It's automatically, and it controls it. The problem is, people disable it. And that can vary from radio to radio. It can be cutting out a diode, a resistor, a capacitor, removing a transistor, removing multiple components in some radios. Doesn't matter what the modification might be. In 99.9% of the cases, it's a bad idea. And it should not be done because you're going to sound like crap after you do it. And there's a good chance your power on channel can decrease. So, what I want to show is, and what we're going to do, so the demonstration, I have the radio hooked up through that coax cable right there, goes over to my BK1040, I'm using that for the dummy load. There is a sampling port attached to this coax cable, and that's what runs into the spectrum analyzer. I also running off the back of the BK1040, there's a port off of that for an oscilloscope, so it's hooked up to that oscilloscope right there. We're going to be modulating the signal into this radio. So I'm not going to be using this microphone, because using a microphone, you can't get a stable reading, because it's a voice. It's a complex waveform coming out of my mouth, and it's not at a continuous level. We want to put a pure tone at a controlled voltage, be able to change that voltage, maybe change the frequency. So we're going to be using the signal generator up here. I have it set up currently to put out a 1,000 hertz tone at 10 millivolts peak-to-peak output voltage. That's a very common when you're doing an alignment. You'll often see in the specifications when it says to adjust modulation, it will tell you to inject some like 7 or 10 millivolts peak-to-peak at a certain tone. Usually, for AM radios, usually that tone is going to be a 1,000 hertz tone. So that's what the signal generator is doing. So that coax cable right there, the BNC cable, comes down and runs into the front of the radio. Now, I have it running into a little... Yeah, I've got, had to stack some adapters here because this little board that I use... Because, like I say, we're not using a microphone. We want to inject this signal straight in, that audio signal straight into the radio. If I had to put this little board and plug it into the radio, I got to turn it around, and it's going to run into this jack. So I had to just put two adapter plugs here back-to-back to move it out away from the radio. But it has a built-in toggle switch in it, so I can switch into it. Matter of fact, you can see right there, it's now transmitting a carrier. So I can... That's all that's for, just the toggle switch is for receive or transmit. And then, but that allows me to inject my audio tone into the radio. And then what we want to view is what that looks like. And we have this little walkie-talkie here, because I can set it on the bench so you can actually see me turn it on, and you'll know the sound's actually coming out of this little radio. Now, I've taken the rubber ducky off of it, because if I leave this on... You know, if I put the antenna on, we're going to be getting a lot more interference noise. We don't want to hear that. So, and the radio, honestly, it's only sitting a few inches away from this radio. So trust me, plenty of RF energy is going to get into this thing. We'll be able to hear it. But I want to show it on not only the spectrum analyzer, but I want to let you hear what happens, how distorted it is. And you'll be able to clearly hear it, you know, coming through a little cheap walkie-talkie, through a crappy microphone in this camera, and then God knows what you're going to be playing this through. You're still going to be able to clearly hear how distorted the signal becomes when you go improperly adjusting. Now, you have to remember... The AMC circuit is still intact in this, so I'm going to be adjusting it. If you completely disable it, it's going to be even worse. It's going to be horrible, as a matter of fact. So, you know, just take what I'm demonstrating here and imagine how much worse it can get, because if you disable the AMC circuit, it's completely out of circuit now. When I adjust it fully in the opposite, you know, for maximum modulation with that adjustment, that's still, it's going to reach a stop. It won't let it go any farther than that. If I were to disable the circuit, it's going to get horribly even worse than that. So, yeah, you can let your imagination go wild there. So, what we're going to do is key the radio. Flip my little toggle switch there. We're going to see the carrier on the spectrum analyzer there. I'm going to turn on the output from that signal generator up there, and you're going to see the modulated waveform on the spectrum analyzer here. So AM communications, when it transmits a carrier. So there is our carrier, okay, right there in the center. And then when I apply modulation at a single tone, what you'll see is there'll be another one of these little peaks. It'll be down a little bit, but you'll see another peak appear over here, and you'll see a peak appear over here. Those are your sidebands. So in sideband communications, what you actually suppress the carrier, and then there will be a crystal filter in the radio that actually filters out that other sideband. So in sideband, that carrier is completely nulled. You'll balance that out, and then, like I say, the radio's still producing two sidebands, and one of those sidebands gets filtered out by the crystal filter. That's why it's... AM is a very inefficient use of band space because it takes up so much band space. Sideband, you can put out more power, but and the radio can do it all in one of those sidebands. But so I'm going to turn on the signal generator now and apply that 10 millivolt peak-to-peak 1,000 hertz tone. And actually, we'll turn the radio on here. Actually, I'll turn the volume down. I don't turn it up too high. So, actually, I can show that up there. That's just this little button here. It was off. Turn it on. Illuminates green, so it's now outputting a signal. And you can see on the spectrum analyzer there, we have we have other products that have showed up. But the two big things is you see that peak right there and that peak right there. That's your lower and your upper sideband. So there's our carrier, our lower and upper sideband. Now, there's some other stuff that showed up down here. Those are distortion products. You're going to have that, you know, the better a radio gets, the better it is. It or preventing stuff like distortion products like that from getting, out of a radio. And that's that's acceptable. It's significantly down in level. The problem is, and if we turn the radio up, we can hear there's a 1,000 hertz tone. Now, what I want to do is adjust this modulation adjustment inside the radio and show you how horrible it's going to look on the spectrum analyzer. You're going to see additional peaks pop up in between here. Now, you have to realize that's the carrier. That's 5,000 hertz. So, halfway between these two, that means that's 500. And same thing down here. This product down here looks like it's probably out at 2,000 hertz. There's 1,000, there's 2,000. Same thing here. 1,000 hertz away from the carrier, 2,000 hertz. You're probably going to see some other products pop up right there and right there. So we'll adjust the modulation limiter up. Actually, wrong adjusting tool. Grab a properly sized one here. And as I increase that, now you see all that shit? Exactly. That's not supposed to be there. That's not supposed to be there. That's not supposed to be there. Neither is that, 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 or that. Okay? What we want to see is minimum amount there, like that. We want to have, and you heard that in the radio, it gets a really roar. That's because you're transmitting multiple tones, all those distortion products. It starts to horribly distort. So we're not just transmitting a 1,000 hertz audio tone anymore. We're transmitting a 500 hertz tone, a 1,000 hertz tone, a 1,500, a 2,000 hertz audio tone. Now, like I say, the ones down here, they're very low, but this 500 hertz tone, that is horribly high. And if you look over at that oscilloscope, I've turned the intensity down. I'm hoping you can see that. Yeah, it might even still be too bright for the camera. I don't know how well, if you can see that, there's actually a ghost. You can see it's like there's one modulation package there, and then there's another much larger one. The much larger one is the 1,000 hertz tone, and it's clipped. It's got a flat top, and then you've got this other one appearing in there. That's your 500 hertz tone. It's not supposed to be like that. If I turn it back down where it's supposed to be, 100% modulation. Good, clean waveform. Sounds good coming out of the monitor radio. Looks good on the spectrum analyzer. So adjust it up, bad. Adjusted properly, sounds good. One of the big things is, it's so much easier on this radio. So let's turn that tone off, and we'll unkey the radio, because I'm sure this is starting to get rather warm. Yeah, she's starting to heat up pretty good. Don't want to burn up my brand new radio. So, that's all you do. Now, that's the trick, though. On a watt meter, and actually, let me turn it back on. So, we'll come over, and I'll actually show that on this watt meter. So, if you watch, I don't know if I can get this camera boom. Try and zoom in with the digital zoom the way I got this camera. I probably get her swung around here a little bit. Of course, this coax cable is just going to be in my way, isn't it? I don't really have the boom set up to be able to swing around backwards like this, but we'll try. So, I don't know how well that's going to show up in camera. Let me transmit. You can see the needle. Okay. So, we're transmitting. I'm going to turn the audio tone back on. Okay. Now, that's transmitting at 100% modulation. Looks good. You can see it's doing 12 watts. Okay. Now, if I adjust the modulation pot, you can see, oh man, it's up to, 20 watts now. Radio's smoking. Exactly. All that crap. The meter doesn't care that it's not the frequency the signal you want to be transmitting. It just reflects all of the power. And if we put it into average, you can see that, okay. So I'm going to turn the audio off. I have the modulation currently adjusted at 100%. So there's no audio tone. There it's modulated. The needle's at the exact same spot. Hasn't really moved up any, okay? It's in average right now, okay? Which is basically what's inside of this radio, the little meter. So you really don't see any forward swing, okay? You see that little blip, and that's why you will see the needle fluctuate while you're talking, because it does take time for the AMC circuit to kick in. But what people adjust for is, now if I turn the modulation pot up, you do see there is a small increase there. It goes up to like 5 watts. Well, yeah, it goes up, but that's all distortion. You haven't gained anything other than sounding like crap. Because this does not have a adjustable 54 megahertz trap circuit, it's actually very clean out at 54 megahertz. So like I say, we're on channel 19, that would be 54.37. So we go out there, we'll just take a look at it just to see. So yeah, it's transmitting right now and there's nothing there. And probably even if I'd get it where it's distorted, it's really not showing anything. There's just nothing there. Because it's non-adjustable. And I actually like that. Well, I mean, from my point of view, as a tech that knows how to properly adjust that and has the equipment to check it, I don't like that because it's not adjustable. Now, granted, it's good. It's, you know, it's clean on the spectrum analyzer. But I actually kind of prefer them not having it in there, because that used to be a common point where people would get in there and tinker with it. And since they've removed the tinker point, it can't be tinkered with anymore. So that's actually, I give them a thumbs up for doing that. Yes, I personally would prefer it to be adjustable. That way, if there was anything showing up at 54 megahertz, I could adjust it out. But yeah, in the grand scheme of things, it's actually better that they made it so it's not adjustable anymore, because there's just too many people with these things out there that are plated in gold. Yes, the golden screwdriver. So, you know, I actually ought to do that just as a joke. I ought to send one of these damn things out. Actually, I can gold plate. I should plate one of those with gold. I can do that with my paste desoldering system. It actually has a pulse plate feature. But so anyhow, there you go. That's why you don't want to. And we'll do something else. So we're trying. Actually, I need to put the frequency back to 27.185 megahertz. Now, actually, the span right now is set to 5 kilohertz, so it's only actually half the CB channel that we're on. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to increase it to, let's say, 30 kilohertz. So that's going to represent from one side of the screen to the other. It's going to represent 3 channels. The channel we're talking on in the middle, and then the 2 adjacent channels. So if we transmit, now if I adjust the modulation up, what you're going to see is it's spread, it starts to sneak into the adjacent channels. See that? You have to remember this is 3 channels wide. So what do we have here? 1, 2, 3. It's actually what's like 2 and... yeah, right about there. So, yeah, it's creeping into the adjacent channels. And like I said, you can see all that other distortion product come up when I do that, when I adjust it up, which we don't want. And it sounds like shit. It's horribly distorted coming out of a monitor radio. So the other thing I want to show is, we'll actually go back down and we'll decrease the span back down to 5 kilohertz so we can more clearly see our modulation there. The next thing I want to do is show you that it helps to keep it not only level with, you know, different frequencies. So actually we'll set the signal generator here. So we have it. I'm going to change the amplitude from 10 millivolts to, let's say, 20 millivolts. So twice the input audio level. No change. 30 millivolts. Really no change. Let's go up to 50 millivolts. That's way more than your microphone's ever going to do. Still, it's come up a little bit, but that's what the AMC circuit's doing. It's keeping it at a... it's trying to keep it at a continuous level. No matter what the changing level coming, you know, in through the mic jack is, it's trying to keep that modulation at the same level all the time. And if we drop back down to 10 millivolts where I had it originally, you can see some of that other distortion products down there did disappear, because at 50 millivolts, that is a massive signal as far as audio is concerned going into a mic jack. That was a screaming amount of power going in there. But that's what that circuit's meant to do. And it can do it over a fairly broad spectrum. So actually, if we change the span to 10 kilohertz, and then I'm going to set up the signal generator here to actually sweep a frequency. So we'll do a sweep time of, let's say, 3 seconds. And we'll do a start frequency of 500 hertz and a stop frequency of 2500 hertz. Got that right? 500, 2500, yes. Okay. So, if we have that turned off, so if we key the radio, you can see our carrier down there. Now, if I turn the output on, so that's what we're doing. We're sweeping through between 500 and 2500 hertz. Now, if I, again, turn the modulation limiter, crank it up the whole way, you can just see all those distortion products, and actually you can probably even see that more out into the adjacent channels now. So if we go back out to 30 kilohertz, or 3-channel spacing, there's a lot more crap, especially at some of the higher frequencies, that are really starting to show up out here, which weren't there before. And you can see on the... you can see how pinched together that is in the middle, the waveform's distorted. Where if I turn it back down where it should be, we have a good, clean, 100% non-distorted signal there. If you look at the spectrum analyzer, you basically have what you want to see, two peaks that stay at a fairly continuous level. They're not changing in amplitude. A little bit of distortion down here, but it's very low. It's really down there. So that's what you want to see. So, we can go back to distorted again and listen. Actually, we can listen to that on the radio here. And adjust it properly. And you really notice it, especially at the lower lower audio frequency, the distortion. It's really gritty and grindy sounding, and that's because it has all those extra, distortion products in there. That's why it's not clear anymore. So, just a video again. I was just, like I say, distorted, not distorted. Why, when someone tells you, they're going to adjust your radio for maximum swing on the meter. Yep, all they're doing is creating maximum distortion. It horribly distorts your voice, people. It just drives me nuts when I hear these people. They sound like they're talking through a crumpled up ball of paper. It's basically what it sounds like. It sounds like they're sitting there just crumpling a piece of paper while they're talking. They're so horrible. It didn't sound like shit. I mean, not trying to be crude or crass about it, but honestly, people, you do. When you go cranking things to the max, your signals become nonlinear. You sound like crap. And there's no other way to put it. And I know everybody's heard it. You'll hear one guy talk, and it's like, it's pleasing to the ear. If I close my eyes, if it was in stereo, I'd think the guy might be sitting right next to me. And then the next guy, it's so distorted, you have a hard time understanding what the hell they're saying. The whole point of two-way communications is to be able to communicate. If the other person's so distorted you can't hear what they're saying, it's kind of senseless to even be having a conversation in the first place. So, here's just another video on why not to peak. The tune part is fine, it's that peak part that's the problem. Yes, you can peak your receiver circuit for maximum sensitivity. You do peak the transmitter circuit, and you do peak your modulation at 100%. The problem is when people peak it for maximum meter readings. That's why I really hate that term. You know, it's 'cause that's what they're doing. They're just, and it looks good on a meter. You take your radio to them, they show you what it's doing. Factory. Okay, here, yeah, you're hardly swinging anything. And then when you come and pick your radio up at, you know, the next day or later on that day when they have it done, and they slap it up on the bench and they show you on a meter, see how much that needle's swinging now, man? Oh, yeah, you're doing all kinds of watts. Yeah, you're doing all kinds of watts all over the frequency spectrum, and you now sound like shit. Best things you can do is get a proper transceiver alignment done, get a good microphone. These work, but honestly, they don't sound that great. They're not going to have the audio bandwidth and the flat, you know, response of a good microphone. So get a good microphone and a good antenna. A good antenna will make you talk farther than the tiny amounts of power you're going to pick up inside of this radio peaking it. Truly, that the better antenna will do, you'll get more bang for your buck out of the better antenna than you will driving this radio well past the red line. And when you also do that, you have to remember you're increasing strain on components in this radio. Your final transistor, it's not going to last as long. You know, radios, I see radios all the time, 30, 40 years old. Transistors are all original, have never been replaced. That's because the radio didn't have a peak and tune job done to it. Radios, when I see radios that have burned out final transistors, guaranteed. Every single time, with a few exceptions, because some other things can go wrong in a radio and cause that to happen, but pretty much guaranteed, if a final or a driver transistor burns out, the radio has been peaked for maximum power, for maximum output. You're running that transistor well past its rating, and it's not designed to do it. Adjust it properly, it'll probably last you the rest of your lifetime, and you'll sound good doing it, and that's the whole key. Or in my opinion, that's the whole idea behind two-way communications, is to not just be talking, but sound good doing it. So there's my thoughts on the peak and tuners.